In this and the following few lectures, we want to look at a couple of classification and regression algorithms that are rather inspired from principles from statistics. So they come more from the statistics community than from the machine learning community, but are very, very successful algorithms and are built on simple principles. The field of methods, I call this randomized classification or regression methods, bagging, boosting, and friends. And we would start with random forests. On this slide you can see a lot of literature. It is also covered in many of the standard textbooks. So for example, in the elements of statistical learning or in understanding of machine learning, there's a chapter. But there are also a couple of nice overview papers, and also the original paper by Breimann about random forests is something that is easy to read. And I also couldn't resist putting some references to our own work, which has been published recently about consistency of random forests. The background of this whole field of research is ensemble methods. So in an ensemble method, the idea is we not only train one particular classifier to achieve a particular task, but we train many classifiers. And we train them in a slightly different manner. So for example, we either train many classifiers on different parts of the training set, or we take different parts of the features, or we might even train different classification algorithms like a decision tree and a k-nearest neighbor classification algorithm, and I don't know, a neural network. And we know that each of these algorithms has strengths and weaknesses. And the idea is now that if you would know about the strengths and weaknesses, in the end, if we combine all these methods and maybe do something like a majority vote or so, then perhaps the result we find in the end is better than the result of each of these individual classifiers. And on a very high level, this is the idea of ensemble methods. So ensemble methods always refers to the area of research where you have a set of classifiers or an ensemble of classifiers or regression functions or whatever you're trying to solve. So you have this ensemble of individual solutions, and then you combine them to produce a new, hopefully better solution to your problem. The background on the field of statistics that from where this comes is maybe the fields of bootstrap and bagging. And as an example, we have seen something similar already, namely the method of cross-validation. So recall, in cross-validation, what do we want to do? We want to estimate a certain quantity, namely the test error. This is one particular number, and we want to have an estimate for this number. So what do we do? We take random subsets of our training set, because in cross-validation we do these random splits, and another set for testing. And then we not only do this once, but we do it a number of times, on hopefully as possible, if possible, on independent test and training sets. And in the end we average the result and hope that the estimate we get in this way is better than the estimate we would have gotten if we just would take one such split and train and test. Now let's maybe do a small outlook to what is bootstrap in statistics. Maybe some of you have seen that before, but maybe some of you haven't. So I want to briefly outline what this is all about. So consider a standard statistics setting. So you have a sample of points that come from some space. It might even be a nice space, Euclidean space or so. And assume you're interested in a parameter. So for example, you might want to estimate the mean of the population. And you have some nice estimator, and it produces an estimate theta hat of the parameter theta. And now you want to know the distribution of this parameter because, for example, you want to have a confidence interval for your estimate. And now the point is, if you know something about the distribution of your sample points, then it's often easy, or not easy, but at least in some cases, it's possible to compute what is the distribution of your estimate theta hat, to compute it analytically, and then you can also analytically compute formulas for your confidence sets. But if you don't know anything about the distribution of your training sets, of your training points, then this is impossible. You simply, if you don't know the distribution, you need to do it somehow more empirically. Okay, and here is now what we do empirically. So we draw a subsample of m points of our original training sample. And now depending on your philosophy and which corner of the bootstrap literature you come from, you do it with or without replacement. And now on this sample of m points, on the subsample, you compute the estimate. So you have your m points, you compute an estimate of the parameter you're interested in. And then you do this again. You again subsample points and compute an estimate and so on. So in the end, you repeat this procedure b times. So b times you draw a subsample of points and compute an estimate. So you end up with b estimates of their parameter, theta 1 hat to theta b hat. And now sort of you can look at the distribution of these estimates. And this somehow gives you an indication, for example, of how large your confidence interval should be. Maybe I give a small illustration on the iPad once. So assume we're in a one-dimensional setting. Sort of the standard situation in statistics, you assume, I don't know, you have data points, they follow a normal distribution. You sample a couple of points, maybe these points here. Now you want to compute the mean, or you want to estimate the mean of the distribution. What do you do? You compute the empirical mean. It might sit here. And then if you know that your original points have been drawn from a normal distribution, then you know that this estimate, so this is your estimate theta hat. So theta in this case would be the mean. And theta hat is your estimate of the mean. And now if you want to know, to put a confidence, so somehow you would like to have a statement which says that if the true parameter, for example, it's a bit more complicated confidence intervals, but intuitively what they do is you want to say that with high likelihood the true parameter sits in this interval. This is not what they really do, I'm aware of this, but just for the simplicity of explanation, let's keep it like this. So you want to have an interval around your estimate where you say, well, this is sort of where I would expect this estimate to sit. And if this interval is small, then you can rely on it. And if the interval is very large, you would say, ooh, I'm not sure I can rely on this estimate. Now, if you know that your data points, for example, are normally distributed, then you know something about the distribution of this estimate theta hat, it's t distributed, and then you can analytically compute the limits of this confidence interval. Now, the other situation is you have no clue how the distribution of your original points looks like, and maybe it looks like this. So this is the distribution that generates your original data points, but you don't even know that this, like, you don't know anything about this distribution. And now again, what can you do? You draw some sample points, you would get a couple of points. Again, what you do is you compute the mean, and in the sample it would maybe sit here. And now you want to know, is this mean, I mean, is my confidence, can I be sort of sure that this is more or less where this mean sits, or could it be that it's very far away? And in this case, you don't have any, you can't make any distributional assumptions. And now this is where Bootstrap comes into play. So what you do now is you say, okay, I do this process again and again, the one of computing the mean. But of course, if you keep the original sample, nothing is going to change. So what you now do is you draw subsamples. Maybe let's put them in green. And you maybe you draw, these are 15 data points, you draw subsamples of say 10 data points and compute the mean. And then you will find sort of maybe these couple of means. I mean, this is not very likely in this particular case, but assume you would find these kind of means, then you would say, well, I've done it 100 times, so it's reasonably likely that the mean would sit somewhere here in this green bar. And then you can decide, well, can I now trust this red estimate of the mean, or maybe do I think this bar is too large, this green bar, and I need to have more data or do something else. So this is sort of the basic intuition of Bootstrap. Now, of course, there exists a lot of theory in the statistics literature that proves under which circumstances this kind of approach makes sense and would lead to consistent estimates and so on. What makes all this literature a bit complicated is that these estimates theta b, of course, are not independent, because if you draw from the same sample, like you have one big sample and now you draw subsamples, these subsamples are not independent, but they would overlap a lot. And now the most complicated part is to sort of disentangle this dependency and find out under which circumstances you still have consistency of these estimates. So this is my one slide, or my two slides, on Bootstrap. It is a very important field of statistics, and of course there's lots and lots and lots of literature. There is a very popular textbook, for example, The Introduction to the Bootstrap by Efron and Tipshirani, who are sort of also the ones who invented this or contributed a lot to this area. There's another one that I like, The Jackknife and Bootstrap by Shao and Tu, but there are many, many more textbooks out there. The other thing I want to briefly explain is the method of bagging. Bagging is an abbreviation for bootstrap aggregation. So here you see bootstrap, the B, and egg from aggregation. So you end up with bagging. And this is now what is close to what we do in machine learning. So as in bootstrap, you now have an original sample. You want to estimate something. You now generate B bootstrap samples of your original sample. Again, so you draw subsamples and compute your parameter theta, your estimate theta hat. And you again get these B different versions of theta hat. And now, in this case, you're not even interested in any confidence intervals or the distribution of this estimate. You just maybe want to know what is now your final estimate. And then you, in the simplest case, you simply take the mean. So you have now B different estimates and you say, well, I take the mean of these estimates. Now, thinking a bit about it, why would this make sense? Because you could also say, I mean, I have my original sample and I can make a bootstrap. I can simply compute my estimate on the original sample right away, and why do I need this bootstrap procedure? The idea is that this bootstrap procedure, this bagging procedure, can lead to an estimate that has a much smaller variance than if you simply do one estimate on your full sample. And the intuition is the following. So if this estimate theta b would be independent from each other, which they are not, but simply assume for now that they would be independent, and each of these estimates would have a variance of sigma squared, then the variance of this combined estimate would be sigma squared over b, because the variance, if you have b independent, a sum of b independent random variables, it is easy to compute the variance of the overall thing. And it decreases by this factor of b. So you have a variance that is smaller by a factor of b, which is of course good, because in the beginning your variance maybe was that large, but now it's so small, so you can sort of rely on this estimate much more. However, of course, in practice these estimates are not really independent, but now you can still think about what would happen if they still have the same distribution, but they have a correlation, but maybe this correlation is not so large. Say the correlation is rho. Then you can again go through the exercise of computing what is the variance of this bagging estimate. And then what you're going to find is this one, the variance of this new bagged estimates. Is essentially, so here you see if rho is zero, which means there's no correlation, they're independent, we recover the result which we had in the previous line. So then rho is zero, the first term disappears. And in the second term, we leave sigma squared over b. So we have this massively reduced variance. But now if there's a positive correlation, then what we are going to see is that this part decreases a bit and we get an additional term depending on the correlation. And so in the extreme case, when the correlation is one, this last term disappears and we retrieve the original variance of the original estimate. And so essentially this approach of bagging gives you the possibility, at least if your correlation is small, you achieve a variance that is much smaller than the original one. If the correlation is not small, you also don't lose so much, because in the worst case sort of you would recover the variance of your original estimate. Okay. And now the idea is that we want to apply this principle to something like classification or regression. So what we are going to do is we are given a set of training points. We now repeatedly take subsamples of this training set and compute a classifier or a regression function based on this training set. And then for a test point, we simply average the outputs of each of these individual models. So we have a test point X. We now compute what each of the baseline classifiers would give you as a result. So what I call baseline classifiers are now these individual classifiers that we could train. And then we simply average over all of this, and this is going to be the result of our bagged classifier. And now by looking or thinking a bit closer about what the mechanism here is, you can already make a couple of remarks on what you think would be good baseline classifiers. Because of course you now can choose everything. You could say I choose SVM, so I choose deep neural networks, I choose whatever you like as a baseline classifier. I do it often on many subsamples and then I combine the result. But there might be baseline classifiers which are better suited than others. And here are a couple of remarks. So the first remark is that this is of course expensive from a computational point of view, because you need to train a model b times. on M data points. And if your data set is large, M is large, and you need to do it often, B is large, then this is really a lot of computational effort. So it might make sense to use a reasonably simple baseline algorithm for training. Don't use a deep neural network as your baseline classifier if you need to train it 1,000 times, then this is maybe too expensive. And so typically what are simple methods? It could be something like a k-nearest neighbor method, it could be a decision tree, it could be maybe if you want still a linear method, but something that is reasonably easy to train. The next thing is what we've seen on the previous slide, begging is supposed to be an approach that reduces the variance, and this happens most if these classifiers are as independent of each other as possible. So this is something we should aim for, making these classifiers independent. And the last comment is, begging is all about reducing the variance of your estimate. It cannot do anything about the bias. So if your method is, your baseline method is biased, and for example, your estimate of this parameter theta always ends up much too high, then if you average over these estimates, which are much too high, then the result is still going to be much too high. So begging cannot do anything about the bias of your method, it can just reduce the variance. This is also important to keep in mind. And now the standard choice that we're going to see in the next in the following bit of the lecture is that we use decision trees as our baseline algorithms because they are simple and also have the potential that we can make them more or less as independent as possible from each other. So let us briefly start with decision trees. I guess most of you have seen decision trees, but if not, here is sort of the image. So the intuition, what a decision tree does is you have, typically you have a set of like points, persons, whatever, patients in a medical example, and each point or person is described by a set of features. And now you have a decision tree and you, for example, want to decide whether the patient should get treatment one or treatment B. And now what you do is you sort of look at the features and the decision tree always tells you, it is sort of a tree that routes you to a treatment. So for example, here's an example, you could say, I first look at the age of the patient. If the patient is above 50, I go in this branch. If the patient is below 50, I go in this branch. Then for the elderly people, you say, I need to look at the blood pressure because this is most important for this population. You check, is it below 120 or above 120? And then you suggest treatment one or two. And maybe for the younger people, you say, well, the blood pressure is maybe not so much of an issue, but the diet is very important. So is the person a vegan person? Then we, for example, cannot use treatment X. We need to use something else. And if the person is not vegan, we do something else, and so on. And the idea is that typically the important variables occur somewhere in the top of the tree, and then the less important variables occur somewhere at the bottom of the tree. Okay. So this is the general principle of a decision tree. And now there are millions of ways in which you can build decision trees. And there's what you typically use in random forests, as we are going to see, or want to explain them in this lecture. We are going to use spatial decision trees. And the spatial decision tree is now something that you might have seen implicitly already. It's something like a KD tree, if you've seen algorithms before. It is a kind of tree structure that splits your data space into different cells in the end. Let me explain how this works. And maybe I think the easiest way would be to explain it on the iPad. So assume we have a data set. I just draw one. Here are lots of data points. And these are just the points. They might have labels because later on we want to solve a regression or a classification problem. But now what I'm going to do, I want to introduce a split to my data, and all splits I'm allowed to consider in these at least basic spatial decision trees are splits that are parallel to one of the coordinate axes. So here I'm in a two-dimensional space, I can either split vertically or horizontally. And now maybe what I would do here, let's put my example like this. So here's the coordinate system. I would say, so often what you can do is you can, for example, say you look at the variance of your data in the two directions and then you split in one direction where the variance is smallest, for example, and you would split here. Oh, this is not a very good, maybe, sorry, I need to make this a bit nicer. Let's put it like this. So this is my first split, so I have now a left and a right side. This is maybe a bit too big. And now I have two cells, and this is in my tree. So here I have, now the question is the x-coordinate, so this is maybe 5. This is the line x equals 5, and now if I build my tree, I have now a first, the root of my tree contains the x-coordinate, and I'm asking, is it smaller than 5 or is it larger than 5? And now in one size, if it's smaller, then I go left, in the other case I go right. And now I do this recursively, so I now look at the different sides. So maybe what I now do is I split the left-hand side, and maybe what happens is I would split it in this way, and then I would add a new vertex to my decision tree, which would say, now here we look at the y coordinate and we check if this is maybe 10. We check, is it smaller than 10 or is it larger than 10? And on the right hand side, what might happen is I again split in the y direction, and then here I would add the coordinate x, because I need to check, maybe this is x equals 7. I need to check, is it smaller than 7 or is it larger than 7? And so you continue recursively. So what you have in the end, you can also see it now on the slide. I have a figure here, so you have data points, and you see essentially where each of the lines introduces a new split of the data set. And so on the left-hand side on the slide, you see the spatial cells that emerge from this kind of tree, and on the right-hand side, you see the tree that is going to emerge. And typically, I mean, to construct such a tree, you do it recursively. In each step, you need to select one dimension along you want to split, and then you need to also decide what is the best point. So if you decided you want to split along the x-axis, you need to still find where exactly do you want to split. And you keep on splitting and splitting until you achieve that each cell only has a certain small number of points that you fix in advance. So you say, I split until each cell has only 10 data points, and then you stop, for example. Now what you need to do is, so assume you have this tree structure, you have constructed it already. How do you use it for prediction? So that's now very simple. You now want to predict, say, the label of a certain point. So what you now do is, you have your test point here in this image. It is this red cross. So you check in which cell would this point live, and you can do that by simply walking along the tree and at each node decide, like, is the x coordinate of this point smaller than 5 or larger than 5, and so on. And then you end up in the cell. And then to predict the outcome of this test point here, you simply average over what you have in your cell, in this final cell. So here this point ends up in this cell, which has 3 data points left. And now in classification, you would simply take the majority vote for these 3 data points. In regression, you would simply take the average label, and this is what you would predict for the test point. Here is again an illustration in case of classification. So this is maybe one of these spatial data structures that you might achieve in the end. And you see sort of you have different points, like white labels or black labels. And what you also see is, like, the color of the cell indicates now what is the prediction for this particular cell. So for example, here we have 3 white points. So the prediction would also be white for everybody, for every test point that ends up somewhere in this cell. Here, for example, at the cell at the bottom, we have 3 black points and 2 white points, so the majority is black. So every test point that would end up in the cell would get a black label. So this is really a very simple, straightforward data structure. There's nothing really secret or mysterious about this. Now, to build the tree, there's one more thing that we need to fix, namely, how do you determine the splitting criterion when you want to find where to split? And there, like in the literature, there are many, many, many such criteria. But here is, I just want to show you an obvious one, which is you sort of look at the test errors that each of the splits would induce, at the training error that each of these splits would induce. So what you would do is you consider a split into 2 different parts and want to say, okay, would this be a good split or a bad split? And now you assume that you would do the split, and then you would compute the test error on the left side and on the right side. And would compute the mean. So let me simply show this with an example. So here I have it's twice the same data set, and I want to decide whether I want to take this split on the left-hand side that goes vertically, or whether I want to use the proposed split on the right-hand side, which cuts it horizontally. So what do? I look at this I first of all look at the left side, look at the split. Now, if I would use this particular split on the right, so I have now a left part and the right side of the split. So on the left side, I have, it's a regression example, I have once the label plus one, once the label zero, and once the label four. Now the prediction on the right hand of the, of the left side of the split would be the average. So this is 5/3. And now I can compute, for example, the L2 error that this would have on the training points on the left hand side. So for the first point, the true label is plus one, but I would predict 5/3. So the error would be 1 - 5/3 squared. Then the same for the middle point, which has label 0, the error would be 0 - 5/3 squared. And for the last point, the error would be 4 - 5/3 squared. And now you can compute it, and the error would be 8.6. You do the same on the other side of your split. The error would be 4.6 in this example. So the overall L2 error here would be 6.6. Now you do exactly the same for the other proposed split on the right side of the image. You find that the error would be 3.6, and you would say, well, the split on the right hand side is better than the one on the left hand side, so this is the one I use. Okay, so you essentially look at proposal splits and evaluate which of them would produce the smallest training error on my training set, and then this is the one you use. And so typically what happens is, you first of all, you need to select the splitting dimension, because the trees, as I explained, they always use axis parallel splits. So for each of the dimensions, you evaluate, would it be good to split along dimension one or to split along dimension two, and so on. So you have a for loop that says for all dimensions. And now for a fixed dimension, you need to find, like, say you want to split in this direction, you still need to find out where on the x-axis, for example, would I need to put the splitting point. So essentially now what you do is you evaluate different splitting points, always compute the L2 error, and then select the one that is best. And if you want to do it computationally, you need to really think about computation time here, because this operation happens often and often and often, in particular if we have many trees also. So typically people use a greedy procedure here, some kind of search procedure to find a good position to split. And then you compute what is this error for splitting along this part, like the best one you find in this particular dimension. You do this for all dimensions, and then you finally use the dimension which achieves the best error in this particular way. The other thing you need to consider is what is the depth of your tree. So how many levels do you go down? And typically the way this is done is you fix a number that is called n leaf on these slides, so the number of points that you want to have in the leaves of your data structure. And there are two different regimes that are important in the literature. One is what is called shallow trees. So in a shallow trees, you don't have too many layers. And now what you want to do is you want to have the number of points in a leaf grow at least slowly with the overall number of data points. So for example, if you have n data points in total, you would say the number of points in my leaf should be something like log n. If you do this, then you would see that the tree you construct in such a way is also statistically consistent. And here I want to refer to this chapter on learning theory, and I think there's also an assignment in this chapter where we look at these axis parallel, we look at a slightly simpler case, but in this learning theory lecture, but it's sort of the same gist. What you need to achieve is that the diameter of these cells slowly shrinks. So if you would have the number of leaves being a number like a constant fraction of n, for example, then the diameter of these cells wouldn't shrink, it would stay constant, more or less at least. And then if you average over something, you would always average over a huge part of your space, and this is not something that, so you would end up with a step function as your classifier. This is probably not what would give you consistency. So so you need to make sure that the diameter of all these cells shrinks, but at the same time you need to assure that within each of the cells you have enough data points you average over, because if you just have a fixed number of data points and this number doesn't grow with n, then you average over the same finite number of points and the variance of your estimate is not going to go to zero. So you probably would need to achieve that the number of points per cell increases, and this is like if you want to achieve both, for example, you can choose the number of points as log n, and then you have achieved both, that the diameter shrinks and the number of points within each cell increases, and you get consistency. And so if you just want to use one single decision tree, this is what you're supposed to do. You try to train the tree until you have log n points in your leaves, and then you use it for classification or regression. Now, what happens in random forests, it's a bit funny, because people observe that in random forests are going to be, we use many of these trees in parallel, as in a bagging procedure. And I'm going to explain it on the next slides. But just to already give the catch away, in random forests, people have often observed that it is better or achieves better result if you train the trees to what is called deep trees. So you really only train to a constant number of points. In the extreme case, you train until you just have one point that remains in your leaf. And then you train the tree. And if you do this, and each of these trees would not be consistent. It's like a one nearest neighbor estimate, essentially. So this is not a consistent estimate. It has a certain error because the variance doesn't go down. But if you combine many of those trees, by combining these trees, we get again the variance small enough. And in the end, it can be consistent. And there's also a geometrical explanation. So somehow what you're going to achieve, maybe I try to illustrate it on my iPad once more, sorry. So if you have a tree, maybe it looks like this, I don't know. And you have sort of this regime where you have log n points in each cell, looks a bit like this. So the diameter is going to shrink, but you still have enough points in your cell. Now if for the same kind of data set you now would construct a deep tree, these cells would be tiny, right? You would have essentially one cell around each of the data points, which would not lead to a consistent estimate. But what now happens is you have the same for many trees, and you sort of now need to consider, you overlay many of these trees. So I try to make a figure that is a bit larger. So here's the data point. And here is maybe the cell that you achieve by the first tree. It just consists of this particular data point. So on itself, this would not lead to a consistent estimate. But now you have many trees. So maybe in the next tree, the cell looks like this. And in the next tree, it looks like this. And then it might look like this and like this. So overall, what you're going to have is, if you look at all these trees combined, then again, the cell would have a considerable size. And the way it would end up is also like in each of these cells, of course, you have, say, one data point, because you train until you have one training point left. But taken together, if you now take many of these leaves, then again, you have a large number of training points over which you average, and then the whole thing can get consistent again. Okay, I mean, this was an excursion. It's not important. You don't need to know this in the exam. I just want to give you a bit of intuition here. Okay, so what are the final remarks about these spatial decision trees, like if you just take one particular tree? And one advantage is that they have a nice interpretability, because you can, as I said, in this decision tree, you could say, like if one axis is the blood pressure and the other axis is the age, you can say, okay, for this patient to end up in this particular category, it is important that the blood pressure is below 120 and the age is above 50. So this is something that at least potentially you can interpret. And there are also many suggested ways to compute scores about how important a certain feature is in such a random forest, like in a decision tree, but also in a random forest. And there's lots of literature on this. So in principle, this is a class of algorithms for which interpretability is something that is in reach. Now, I've only shown you like the spatial partitioning tree as one example for a decision tree. There are many, many examples out there. Like a very popular one is the C4.5 algorithm that tries to order the variables according to some information theoretic quantity. So which of the variables is most important regarding the decision we want to take later on. And the important variables end up on top in the tree, and the less important variables end up somewhere in the bottom of the tree.